they say it's to celebrate creativity. So it's Article 1, Section 8, Clause 8, gave Congress the power to enact laws to promote the progress of science and useful arts by securing for limited times to authors and inventors the exclusive right to their respective writings and discoveries. So right now, copyright owners, if you own the copyright to something, you have the legal copyright to that until your death, plus 25 years. So something that somebody wrote in 1776, is it pretty safe to say that that copyright now is public domain? Because there's nobody around from 1776, because they've been dead for a while, plus 25 years, right? So there was a law a few years ago that they wanted to reenact. It's called the Sonny Bono Clause, where they wanted to make it 75 years. So because Sonny Bono died, he's been dead probably, what, 15, 20 years?
At least.
And so they wanted to enact, his estate holders wanted to enact that, so it was for 75 years to protect what?
His
legacy, his what? His estate, right? So that they were able, same thing with Elvis Presley, right? He's been gone for over 25 years, so anything that he wrote or created, they wanted to ensure that. I don't, you know what? I'm going to have to look on it, because I don't know if it's still the 25 years or not. That's something I have to look into. But there are reasons that people want to keep these copyrights or own the royalties, those kinds of things, because they want to be able to have their legacy continue to sustain some type of an income from that work.
Now, do you know who Sonny Bono is?
Sonny and Cher?
Yep.
All right, good. Okay. Just double checking to make sure we knew who Sonny Bono was.
So it's to give the creator control of the monopoly and royalties for a period of time that promotes creativity. It was Copyright Revision Act of 1976. All creators, including photographers and illustrators, are entitled to be paid for their work if it is used commercially or otherwise. This is encourages creativity, makes more images available for use. So the current copyright law, under the current copyright law, attaches upon creation. It's a federal system, which means that the same law applies in every state. It's not different in Nebraska than it is in New York. And a significant change from the prior acts is that the creator is presumed the owner in most situations. So you know you'll have a really hit song that'll come out, and then all of a sudden, you know, 6 months later, you'll see a lawsuit that somebody else is saying, well, they stole 50% of my song, and I really should have had that hit instead of somebody else. These lawsuits are around all the time. Copyrights protects original works of authorship. They're fixed in a tangible form of expression. The fixed form does not have to be directly perceptible so long as it can be communicated with the aid of a machine or other device. So if you stand up at a poetry jam and you just are doing some improv and you spit out one of the most profound poems of all time, and somebody else records that or writes that down, who owns that copyright? Who owns that poem?
They do.
Do they? Does not have to be directly perceptible as long as it can be communicated with the aid of a machine or a device. So somebody recorded it, right? So who owns the copyright? It's always the creator. Whoever creates it is the one who owns that. So if I break into song and it's really good and somebody YouTubes me, I'm getting paid. They're a hard crowd. They're not laughing. They're not doing it. Am I not funny?
No, they just listen very well.
I used to be very funny.
They listen very well.
Okay. How many of you guys have all heard this before? I broke the chair. You guys all heard this before? So he's just like, yawn? Okay. So, literary works, all text including software, musical works, dramatic works. I'm dramatic, so. Pantomimes, choreographic works, pictorial, graphic, and sculpture works, motion pictures, and other audiovisual works, sound recordings, architectural works. So if I go into SketchUp and I draw a really cool Coliseum, and I post it out there on Flickr or someplace else where I want to share that, and then somebody comes in and they have a competition for a new monument somewhere, and my design wins, have I been infringed upon? It depends. We'll talk about that in a little bit too. Insert your favorite photo. That's not my favorite photo. I think that's kind of funny. I got this PowerPoint off the web. And so it was from an organization called PACA, Picture Archive Council of America. And I think somebody forgot to take the insert your favorite photo here off there. And they put that favorite photo in. It's kind of funny. So an example of images to enhance the program. This is just a clip art filler from, so just to put a piece of clip art in there, right? So this is a true story. I'm going to Google And I'm looking to do an article because our school is going to offer driver's ed this summer. We got a grant. We're going to offer driver's ed for free. I found a really cool picture on Google Images of a student driver car, and I put it on the website to announce this new thing. So I got it on Google Images, and I put it on the website. Okay? Is that okay to do? I mean, there was nothing on it. It was just a picture. I just put student driver car, and a picture came up on Google Images, and I just copied it because, you know, you just do that right-click thing and copy image, right? And I used it in my article. Is that okay?
No.
Why?
Not yours.
But it was on Google Images. Why isn't it mine? If they didn't want me to use it, they shouldn't have put it up there, right?
Well, it was signed by someone else. Like, it was put up by someone else, so you have to cite it.
It was.
Oh, but I did cite it. I said I got, you know, picture harvested from Google Images.
But it's from a website.
Yeah,
that's why. You can, like, go to view on page, you know, and then, yeah, there's your proof.
So if I just said view on page and I directed it back to that website, could I still use it in my article then? It'd be okay if I did it then? What you're describing is a term called attribution. So I gave the proper attribute to that. Okay? True story. In a school district not far from here, and not very long ago, great person, fabulous guy, webmaster for the school district, was told to put up an article on the school website about driver's ed, went out, found this picture on Google, put it on there, cited the source, put it right on that website. 3 years goes by. These kids are now all driving back and forth to school because they went through driver's ed and everything. 3 years. Article hasn't been seen by anybody in the district for 3 years because it's been archived through their web system. They get a letter in the mail from a company that posted that picture on Google Images, with a letter that says, you owe us $25,000 for the use of this photo.
Oh my gosh.
True story. True story. The school district settled for $2,500.
Wow.
Now imagine if you look at a school website, how many pictures are on a school website, and you're paying somebody $2,500 a pop because some well-intended person took a picture off of Google and put it onto your website. Your school district's liable for that. There's no argument. There's no way around it. He didn't have permission to use the picture. But it was just on Google Images. It was just a, you know, pretty interesting photo. And so what do you think that school district does now? They're not pulling any images from Google Images without making sure that they have copyright permission to use those photos. So for your intents and purposes, you find something on Facebook that you find incredibly funny, a meme or something like that, and you share it with somebody else. Have you broken copyright law?
Yeah.
We all do this every day, don't we? Our culture has gotten to the point where there's so much sharing going on that that people just aren't even aware anymore that they are openly breaking copyright on a regular basis.